Okay, everyone, we are going to get started. Thank you all for joining us for our very first seminar in Ukrainian studies of the new year and the spring term. A special thank you to our speaker, Joshua Zimmerman, and our moderator, Patrice Dabrowski. So I will introduce Patrice very briefly, and then I'll turn things over to you so that you can introduce our speaker. Patrice Dabrowski is an associate of the Ukrainian Research Institute for many years, and she is an expert in Central and East European history. Her third and most recent monograph, The Carpathians, Discovering the Highlands of Poland and Ukraine, came out in 2021 and has since been recognized with multiple book awards. Congratulations on that. And I want to take this opportunity to recommend, we did have a book talk with Patrice in November 2021. So you can find that on our YouTube, on HURI's YouTube channel, and go check out that to learn more and of the book. So again, thank you, and I'll turn things over to you.
Wonderful. Well, thank you everyone for coming today to this first seminar on Ukrainian studies. You know who I am now. Thank you for that lovely introduction. And it is my honor and privilege to be able to moderate today's session and to introduce today's speaker. Joshua Zimmerman is a professor of history at Yeshiva University, where he holds the Eli and Diana Zborowski Professorial Chair in Holocaust Studies and East European Jewish History. He's probably no stranger to the area because he did his PhD at Brandeis University, a university down the street. Now, his CV is rather long, so I will just pull out a few items from it. He has written a number of books, edited several, and authored himself three monographs, the first one being Poles, Jews, and the Politics of Nationality, the Bund and the Polish Socialist Party in Late Tsarist Russia, 1892 to 1914. Then he also wrote The Polish Underground and the Jews, 1939 to 1945, a book that was also translated into Polish, I understand. And the reason that he is probably here today, his most recent monograph, this wonderful, comprehensive, and some would say definitive English language biography of Jozef Pilsudski, entitled Jozef Pilsudski, Founding Father of Modern Poland. It's my pleasure also to add that this week, a book review will come out in the TLS. So it's getting the attention that it deserves. As far as Professor Zimmerman's interest in Ukrainian subjects go, you may be interested to note that he has just published an article called The Rise of the Ukrainian National Movement in Austrian Galicia. But even more so, he has been a prolific writer of newspaper articles since last year, writing pieces for Politico, The Daily Beast, Kyiv Post, Washington Post, and other such publications. And all of these show his interest in things Ukrainian and his support for the Ukrainian independence. Today's topic is Pilsudski and the Kyiv Campaign, May to June 1920, why Poland championed Ukrainian independence. And I think we're all very eager to hear what he is to add to the subject of Poland championing Ukrainian independence, a topic about which we all know from at least the last year. So we'll get the historical perspective now.
Well, thank you very much. Let me just make sure I time this so I don't go over. Here we go. So do we go here? Okay, thank you.
Please, floor is yours. Okay.
And Yes. No. Well, I want to just begin by thanking the Harvard Ukrainian Institute for inviting me here to speak on my new book. The staff of the Ukrainian Harvard Institute, which is so friendly and competent. Thank you. Okay, so there's no greater example than what is going on in Ukraine today, which we're experiencing daily, and is a tragic event, the largest land war in Europe since 1942. So the way I'd like to structure is to talk about a couple main takeaways that are that come out of the these four. Then I want to just say something about the life of Pilsudski. What shaped this figure, who's so central in the history of Poland and who stands as such a monumental figure in Polish in Polish national thought and collective memory. He's also a figure who kind of dots the urban landscape in Poland, right? And for those who've visited, you'll notice that there's a Pilsudski Street in every city and I think every town. Then there's monuments and there's statues. And often there's more than one of those. And so you have kind of this extraordinary figure. I give the example that in 2015, I happened to be visiting Poland just at the time of the presidential elections. And I was really struck by this, is that we had we had the two candidates running against each other, Komorowski and Duda. But then, because it happened to be the 80th or 85th anniversary of Pilsudski's death, there was a lot of commemorations about Pilsudski. So there were like posters of Pilsudski, but they were larger than the ones of the two candidates. And so it made me realize that if there were, tourists coming to Poland, they may have thought that the favorite candidate was this figure named Pilsudski, that he was running for president. He
probably was.
And they actually had interesting images that were that were like colored photos. So it actually looked like it was from someone today. And indeed, it's interesting that both will claim the legacy of Pilsudski. Now, there seems to be the two, opposite political sides in Poland, both seem to claim some kind of heritage from Pilsudski, or at least honor Pilsudski, which is a huge contrast from before the fall of communism. So now I'd like to say something about these four, what I call the four takeaways. So what is distinctive? What are the distinctive features of this figure, Jozef Pilsudski? So my first takeaway is that I argue that he was the only European statesman after World War I to champion the independence of Ukraine. Now, when I say that, when I kind of like articulate that sentence, express that in this context, and again, I'm very excited at the opportunity to discuss this in a Ukrainian institute forum, because I understand that Pilsudski is a controversial figure in Ukrainian history, but it does seem, and it'll be interesting for me in the discussion if someone has information to the contrary, that we don't have other European statesmen after World War I who are explicitly championing the independence of Ukraine. So the question for me is, why was this one figure in this new state, Poland, what was behind his championing? Because this was taking quite a risk, and it was also putting Polish boots on the ground in April, May, June of 1920 in the Ukrainian-Polish campaign to wrest Kyiv from, at that time, the Bolsheviks, because it had gone back and forth. An independent Ukrainian republic. So that's my of May 1926, and then the turn to authoritarian rule in Poland. So it's a specific era in Polish history, and Pilsudski's foreign policy is criticized, and then his subversion of some democratic norms as well. But people often forget that when Poland emerged as a state on November 11th, 1918, that this one figure, Pilsudski, emerges, and the acting authorities, which was called the Regional Council, which was a Polish body, but it was appointed by the Okay. The transition is it's very transparent as well. That's to say, on, for example, the 18th of November, a provisional governor is named. 10 days later, the first electoral law is drafted. It's a liberal electoral law that gives women the right to vote, universal suffrage, making Poland the fourth country in the Western world to give women the right to vote. But it also critically and importantly names a date for elections to a constituent assembly in that document. So in other words, before the end of November 1918, we already have this transparent move towards a democratic government. And in fact, of course, there are some bumps on that road to getting to that election, because at this point there is a rival government in Paris, a political opponent of Pilsudski, but he's able to kind of negotiate with this rival body to form a coalition, naming Paderewski prime minister. And those elections, do they take place on January 26, 1919? They are fair and free. And that body, that first freely elected parliament, does convene on February 10th, 1919, and Pilsudski opens up the inaugural session. It's a very emotional moment, right? Because he had dreamed of a reborn Poland his whole life. He was now 50 years old, and his dream came true. And there he gave a dramatic speech, and then resigned as head of state and left the chamber. In other words, keeping his promise that a legitimate head of state is one who is elected by the people, not someone who is named by the acting authorities who were placed there by an occupying power. Then he is unanimously reinstated as a head of state. And then at that point, he is legitimate head of state. There are some unusual things that happen between the independence of Poland on November 11th and his being named head of state. And one of them I will come back to has to do with the Jews and pogroms that break out in the wake of the independence of Poland. And that is that when pogroms do break out in the last 2 weeks of November 1918, Pilsudski meets with on two occasions with representatives of the Polish Jewish community. And there they ask him to make a formal statement condemning this anti-Jewish violence. And he refuses to do so. So this is one of those aspects of his biography that is criticized often, because he says he doesn't have authority to speak on behalf of the state. This is his argument. He wasn't elected head of state, so he can't speak on behalf of the state. And so he tells the Jews, who feel clearly betrayed, that when that constituent parliament convenes, and if they then choose him as head of state, then he will make statements. But at this point, he cannot speak in the name of Poland as a whole. So that definitely, among at least in Polish Jewish historiography, is critiqued. Now, I would say that the third distinctive feature that I bring out in this book, in this biography, is that I argue that Pilsudski was the only European statesman to accurately assess the dangers of the rise of Nazi Germany at the moment when it was taking place. So when Hitler came to power, about 1.5 months later, there is a claim that Pilsudski sent a secret envoy to Paris and presented to the French the proposal for a joint preventative war to remove Hitler from power. And the argument was that Germany is still under treaty obligations of the Versailles Treaty, and they are demilitarized. At that time, Poland's armed forces were almost three times that of Germany. France's were five times that of Germany. And he argued that essentially we have a window of time, because he argued that if we allow this man to rearm, he will create havoc in Europe, and the result will be a catastrophe. Now, the controversy in the literature is that some say that proposal was never actually presented to the French, and we don't have evidence that it actually was. But what I do find in the book is that in March, April, and May of 1935, British, German, and French diplomatic cables makes explicit reference to a Pilsudski's preventative war. And so it does appear that what is that it's a feature of his diplomacy to curb authoritarian regimes and curb aggression by first threatening or taking action and then falling with diplomacy, rather than what would happen after Pilsudski's death in 1935, which was a policy of appeasement, which is to try to negotiate a settlement and only react once Germany does actually encroach on its neighbor's territorial integrity. And just want to say that the trigger for this whole preventative war idea was that at the end of February 1933, less than a month after Hitler took power, he gave an interview with the British newspaper in which he said he will be taking back Danzig and the corridor. It's not a question of if, it's a question of when. So that would be my third takeaway about something that is unique about him, that he seemed to be in some ways able to see, foresee what the future will be based on current conditions more than other statesmen at the time, I would say. And then the fourth takeaway I argue in my book is the fourth takeaway is his special relationship with the Jews. And that is that we should remember that within the boundaries of the Second Polish Republic lived Europe's largest Jewish community and the world's second largest, that one in every three European Jews lived within this state. And Pilsudski, is this figure that is considered a friendly figure for the Jews, a protector of the Jews. His nickname was Giadi. His nickname was like Giadic, like grandfather. In recent studies, it does show that between 1921, when the frontiers were settled, there were no more border wars, and his death in 1935, we don't have evidence of any widespread anti-Jewish violence. But what I document in the book is that 10 days after his death, there is an outbreak of anti-Jewish violence in Grodno, and one of the Jewish victims left a testimony saying that what these thugs told to him was that now that your grandfather's gone, it's fair game on the Jews, right? Now this can come to the surface. So that was, I thought, a specific, special, kind of status that he had. And in Polish Jewish collective memory, I would say that's very critical. Now, if I want to do the PowerPoint, do I just share right here, right? Okay, I'll just share this here. It comes up. Is it not coming up? Sorry. Okay. There we go. Thank you. And this is just to, go to this couple of things that I had on the Jewish thing. Okay, so that was here. Okay. And it's one aspect I would just say of his political development. And this is covered in that, right? Is there a way to uncover that? Is that he, as a leader of the Polish Socialist Party in the 1890s, he consistently made statements against anti-Semitism. And this is just an example. It came from, this is just one example. It came from his newspaper, Robotnik, on 13 February 1898.
in which he wrote a piece called On the Jewish Question. And this is one of those statements. He says, our fight, it's the one right before that. Okay, which is, he writes that any trace of anti-Semitism among our comrades will be persistently fought against, and under no circumstances will we allow the manifestation in the life of our movement. So it's an important statement. He makes other ones on this exact, and one thing is he critiques of Tsarist Russian legislation against Jews, the Pale of Settlement and others. And he finds that, in his view, a very important aspect of it. So what I'd like to do now is I'm going to unshare here, and I'm going to now going into my discussion of Ukraine, right? So here we have what I would say was a political leader who's now head of Poland. But I do want to say something just about his convictions and kind of like what we can maybe say are his the self-image he has of Poland is that he's grows up as a great admirer of Napoleon. And so the value he attaches to Napoleon, he's a fanatical follower, a reader of Napoleon's writings. He thinks Napoleon was the greatest military genius in history, is not only his military prowess, in his view, the use of force to liberate captive people. And I think that this is one of his beliefs in his mission as a leader, is that he could, as a military commander, liberate captive peoples. And he will make that statement that he believes that for him, he doesn't want to conquer unfriendly peoples, but he makes this argument that in the borderlands between Poland and ethnic Russia, as long as Ukrainians, Belarusians are unfree, then Poland can never be secure. So he has this argument, and then he says that his mission in Eastern Europe corresponds to France's mission in the West, which is to bring freedom to captive peoples. And again, I realize how controversial that can be in a Ukrainian forum, precisely because he took Lviv right after World War I and then annexed East Galicia went to war with the West Ukrainian Republic. Okay, so what I want to do now is focus in on the actual Kyiv campaign, and look at again the task here is that I'm not a Ukrainian specialist. We have, of course, internationally renowned Ukrainian specialists in the room will be able to discuss things from a Ukrainian perspective. I'm looking at this special campaign, this unique moment in April, May of 1920, when General Pilsudski signed a political and military agreement with General Symon Petlura, known as the Treaty of Warsaw, formally recognizing the independence of Ukraine on the Dnieper with Kyiv as its capital. And it was, according to the opinion of many in the West, a kind of reckless military move, and he was hotly criticized for it. And one message that he had when he responded to the West, as he looked and responded by saying something like, in his words, without an independent Ukraine, Poland can never be secure. And so he continues to, in a way, instruct the Western democracies that they don't really understand Russian political nature, which he makes the claim is, quote, annexationist. So I'll begin with the text of the lecture about Ukraine. So we start with this, that in late 1919, Pilsudski, head of state and commander in chief of the Polish of reborn Poland, concluded that his only hope for pushing Russia back to its ethnic frontiers was to forge an alliance with Ukrainian military leaders in a quest to form an independent Ukraine. Sorry, is there a way I can, I'm just, oh, I'm just going to go back in here. And if I'm able to get to this map, I'm going to go to it. Oh, okay. So it's, I'm seeing that for some reason that map may not have gotten in. Oh, here it is. Okay. So I'm just going to, how do I? Okay. Thank you. Sorry about the disruption there. But what I just wanted to note is that in his mind, is it not working? It's all right. It's not essential. We can unshare and I'll just continue on. For some reason, it's not working. Okay. So what I want to say is in his scheme, Poland would push Russia back to its frontiers, not of 1772, but prior to the first partition of Poland, really back to before the Khmelnytsky uprising, when Kyiv was, and the Kyiv region was part of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. He argued that only then could an independent Ukrainian national state form with Kyiv as its capital. Now, Pilsudski's view emerged in 1919 after he failed to secure support from Britain's Prime Minister David Lloyd George, who opposed any Polish military venture east of the Bug River. Now, Pilsudski nonetheless forged ahead, holding talks in Warsaw on December 9th, 1919, with General Symon Petlura, who by then was already a kind of legendary a figure. He was head of the directory of the Ukrainian National Republic and commander of its armed forces. He had been an essential figure in the Ukrainian national movement since the beginning of 1918. And so this was a very critical moment to form this alliance. Now, we should also note that Petlura had just fled Kyiv after it was taken by the on December 5th. So he fled Kyiv, and then he then proceeded to Warsaw and to sign this to begin a negotiation. Now Pilsudski was clear with the Allies, telling them that Poland was on the front lines against a Bolshevik invasion of Europe. Let me put this here. Of Europe. Now, the conflict, he stressed, was not only about Poland's and Ukraine's territorial integrity or the rights of peoples to self-determination. He said it was about the survival of Western democracy. It is for this reason that Pilsudski stressed to the Western democracies that the great powers of Western Europe needed to provide not only diplomatic support, but also robust military and economic aid. At this point, he's speaking about the fear of a Bolshevik invasion, a Bolshevik encroachment. And he has secret intelligence that is telling him about the plans of the Red Army in contrast to the peace talks that they're putting feelers out about. Now, as I stated, for example, in my interview with Gazeta Wyborcza last August, 2022, some of Pilsudski's appeals to the West, Western democracies, are almost word for word the same as President Volodymyr Zelensky's repeated statements to the West in the last year, saying that military aid to Ukraine is not only about Ukrainian territorial integrity, it is about defending Western democracy against authoritarian aggression. And it's interesting that Pilsudski will take up this exact argument about the importance of Ukraine. He will argue that the independence of Ukraine does not only constitute its importance, it would not only be a security wall to between Russia and the West, but it would be that Eastern outpost of Western democratic tradition, which in his mind goes back to the heritage or territory of the Commonwealth. Now, going back to Pilsudski, while in the process of forming a military alliance with Petlura, Pilsudski, believing he now had more leverage, also engaged in talks with Soviet leaders. Once again, he thought perhaps he could, in negotiations, bring about his plan for an independent Ukraine by getting an agreement with the Bolsheviks. So he entered talks with the Bolsheviks, demanding what he said is a free hand in the borderlands. And in we know that in that peace proposal that Pilsudski proposed, he called for an independent Ukraine and an independent Belarus. The Soviets replied in the negative. Now, the breakdown in Polish-Soviet talks in March 1920 led Pilsudski to conclude that force alone would remove the Russians from Ukraine, whether white Russians or red Russians, so imperialists or Bolshevik, as well as from other lands like Belarusian lands. But it wasn't only the breakdown of peace talks. It turns out that, that in March 1920, Pilsudski's army intelligence had just discovered a secret Russian report from the Red Army's chief of operations to Trotsky, dated January 27th, 1920. Now, the document called for an energetic and decisive strike against Poland to take place in May of the same year to seize Western Ukraine and Western Belarus, then actually in Polish hands. At this point, we should know that in 1919, Poland has been expanding eastward, and parts of these areas are under Polish control. Now, at the time, Pilsudski sat down with the Warsaw correspondent of a French newspaper who asked the marshal, by this time Pilsudski had the title of Marshal of Poland, why he appeared so reluctant to trust the Russian peace proposals at this point from the Red Army, because we're already in 1920. And Pilsudski replied in a manner that I think it has a huge contemporaneous overtones with the war in Ukraine today. And I quote, "We cannot believe anything Russia promises, for Russia promises when it is forced to do so and then goes back on its word the moment its strength is renewed." In that same interview, this is on page 339 of my book, I want to just mention that he also makes a very important statement there, which is that he says, quote, this is the same interview, "Without regard to who will govern in the end Russia, whether," he says, it's imperialist or Bolshevik, he says, one could even say the fundamental feature of Russian political nature is annexationism. So he's using this word, annexationism. And so what he's trying to kind of communicate to the West is that Russia can't actually be trusted in negotiations. So it's kind of an insight that he writes because the Western democracies in some ways are becoming appeasers and believing that Pilsudski is provoking Russia. Now, the above-cited intercept of the cable to Trotsky reinforced Pilsudski's hunch that Russia's intention in Poland was annexationist in nature. He thus proceeded to finalize a political agreement with General Petlura in Warsaw on April 21st, 1920. I may have placed this on. Oh, thank you. On 1920, in which Poland formally recognized. Oh, did this happen again? I think I just have to, if I put this here. Okay. Sorry about that. In which Poland formally recognized the independence of Ukraine on the Dnieper with Kyiv as its capital. And so I think it's an important kind of moment in post-World War I history. Now, this was followed by a military agreement signed on April 24th in what became known as the Treaty of Warsaw. Now, the central compromise for Petlura was conceding East Galicia and Western Volhynia. And even though at the time that would not have much military significance for this particular a battle against to take Kyiv, Professor Plochy in his book on Ukraine, does comment that it had a more enormous symbolic significance that this took place. Of course, we can say that that those leaders of the West Ukrainian Republic, the republic that had been forced to dissolve, not to dissolve, but whose troops had already moved into past the Zbruch River and out of Polish control, these leaders hotly resented and criticized this move on Petlura's. But one could also maybe ask, what was the alternative at that moment for Petlura? It was no Ukraine in any form, perhaps because we should remember that Poland was the only country that was actually offering to put Polish boots on the ground, armed forces in harm's way in a joint venture with the Ukrainian armed forces under Petlura to wrest Kyiv and to declare an independent Ukraine. Now, France and Great Britain, for example, we should recall, argued that the very idea of sovereign Ukraine constituted incitement and provocation against Russia. So the very idea. So it's interesting to me that because while Pilsudski signed this agreement, he's being hotly criticized in the West. And the idea is that if you go into this part that Russia claims as its own, you are provoking and inciting war. Pilsudski and his supporters fundamentally disagreed, claiming it represented a misunderstanding of Russia. So Pilsudski turned to the Western democracies and made this kind of famous statement, which was, Europe will never be secure without an independent Ukraine. So I thought that that was an important aspect. Let me just see where. Okay, so that was an important aspect of his vision of the organization of European states, in which Ukraine is the linchpin. It's kind of the precondition for true security in Europe. And again, I think that has huge contemporaneous relevance. Today, the West, doesn't depart from its complete, at least rhetorically, support for the territorial integrity of Ukraine and the importance of its sovereignty. There's, of course, differing levels of commitment within the EU and NATO. Now, on April 25th, 1920, Pilsudski ordered a military offensive in Ukraine, his troops marching eastward in conjunction with Petlura's forces. Pilsudski was full of zeal. The spirit of the army is magnificent, he wrote in a cable to his prime minister on April 26th, 1920. Now, anticipating substantial criticism among the Western allies, United States, France, and Britain, Pilsudski issued a proclamation to the peoples of Ukraine on April 26, 1920. It was an extraordinary appeal of an invading force, almost Napoleonic in zeal. Its central idea was that the Polish army's intention was to spread liberty into an area of Europe under threat of Russian domination. Now, the leaflet was distributed in every Ukrainian city, town, and village that was liberated by the joint forces. And this is part of the language of the leaflet, of the circular quote, and I'm just quoting Pilsudski, because it's signed by Pilsudski, General Pilsudski, on my orders, the armies of the Polish Republic are advancing forward, marching deep into lands of Ukraine. He says the Polish armed forces will remain in Ukraine only so long as it will be necessary to transfer the administration to a legitimate Ukrainian government. When the national government of the Ukrainian Republic has established its authority, when the troops of the Ukrainian people have taken hold of its frontiers, then the Polish soldiers will withdraw. Until that time, full civil rights will be the law of the land at the time. Now, what did Polish soldiers think about this? And I found this very interesting, which is that one of the Polish soldiers in this campaign was named Kazimierz Sokołowski. He was a 19-year-old Warsaw University student volunteer. And on April 28th, so 2 days after the circular was distributed, Sokołowski jotted down his reaction to the movement of Ukrainian Polish forces in the direction of Kyiv. And here's what he said, quote, the Polish and Ukrainian armies personally led by General Petlura and General Pilsudski, have broken through Bolshevik lines, seizing Zhytomyr yesterday, taking Russian prisoners of war, and is now advancing towards Kyiv. Then he makes a specific comment on the actual leaflet that was distributed. He says, he remarks that, quote, the significance of Pilsudski's appeal to the Ukrainians is, morally speaking, enormous. Through his mouth flows the slogan of Polish democracy, free with the free, equal with the equal, the ancient act of the Union of Hadyach. He wrote, referring to the 1658 act providing for Ukraine to be a third constituent member of the Polish Lithuanian Commonwealth. And then this last statement he makes is really a statement that many Polish diplomats make today. He says Polish wants an independent Ukraine because it well knows that without it, Russia will be right at its doorstep. Okay, let me just time that one. Okay. So I'm going to go to, great. Now, we also know that Petlura issued a parallel appeal or manifesto. In that manifesto, General Petlura communicated to his fellow Ukrainians that the Polish armed forces under Pilsudski's command had come not as conquerors, but as allies based on signed agreements recognizing the independence of Ukraine with Kyiv as its capital. They would withdraw once the war with Russia had ended. This was a part of that appeal. Now, some question Pilsudski's sincerity in promising a future withdrawal, yet what I found is that his statements in private were exactly the same as his statements in public, and they were completely consistent. So, for example, when a for example, he makes an appeal. He says these exact things to the foreign press, which he says, for example, I have no plans of conquering Ukrainian lands east of what is the border now. And he said that his goal was to liberate captive peoples. And so he says this. At a time when the Polish armed forces fight a common enemy side by side with the brave Ukrainian troops in the name of the old Polish slogan for your freedom and ours, the successful joint struggle between the Ukrainian Republic and Poland will bring forth lasting prosperity and peace. Now, this was a cable to his generals, in which he also said, remember that this occupation should be seen in terms of months and not in terms of years. So I think that was important. Now, on May 7th, 1920, units of Pilsudski's cavalry entered Kyiv, followed by Ukrainian infantry. Here, at the peak of his Ukrainian campaign, Pilsudski issued an order to his top commanders, in which he said, just as I said before, that remember that this is a temporary move to allow for the independence of Ukraine, and we must, and his plan is to withdraw within months, and it cannot be calculated in terms of years. Now, with the aim of separating Ukraine from Russia, Pilsudski now fought for an independent Ukraine on the Dnieper, linked to Poland by a political and military alliance. Now, after Kyiv fell, it was reported that Ukrainian forces were now moving southward. And so that it was from Kyiv, and now more and more territory is being taken. And so successful and swift was the Kyiv campaign that by May 16th, 1920, it's estimated that tens of thousands of Russian POWs were in Polish hands. Now, we can discern Pilsudski's mindset at the time through the address he delivered on May 17th in Vinnytsia. I have an image in the PowerPoint, but I think it's too complicated to get that up. But it was in Vinnytsia, which was the temporary seat of the Ukrainian Republic, and there he stood next to Petlura, and he made what I think was a kind of defining statement when he believed that this would be successful. Poland, Pilsudski said, cannot remain sovereign as long as the peoples of the borderlands between it and Russia remain unfree. And I think this is a central statement of Pilsudski's. He continued that Poland, having achieved the great treasure, freedom, has decided to reject all things threatening it as far as possible from its borders. I support a free parliament and a free Ukraine. Long live a free Ukraine. So that was his statement standing next to Petlura on May 17th. Now, as everyone knows here, this campaign ended up, unfortunately, not being successful. And starting in the middle of May, the Bolsheviks began a counteroffensive under Mikhail Tukhachevsky that became wildly successful. I have something here in the PowerPoint about that, but I'll skip showing that because I'm coming to the end of the time, of our time. But what we know is that on June 11th, the last Polish and Ukrainian soldiers were evacuated from Kyiv, and the Bolshevik forces started repelling the Poles and the Ukrainians, and they were wildly successful. So that by, let's say, August of 1920, they reached the outskirts of Warsaw. So when we get to the day of August 16th, 1920, by that time, the Red Army is within 6 to 7 miles of Warsaw, and all of Europe is now of course, in turmoil because a cable has been intercepted in which the commander on the ground, Tukhachevsky, made the statement that, quote, he says, quote, in the West, the fate of world revolution is being decided on our bayonets. We will bring happiness and peace to the toiling masses of mankind. The hour of attack has struck. To the West, on to Vilna, Minsk, Warsaw, and beyond, forward. And then as they approach Warsaw, as everyone knows, on the 16th of August, Pilsudski with his generals devised a counteroffensive that was wildly successful and ended the threat of a Bolshevik incursion into Europe. And they were able to rout the Russians 25 miles back within 2 days, and then really to pursue them in defeat. So that's called the so-called miracle of the Vistula. But then, of course, it ends for the time being the relationship between Poland and Pilsudski and Petlura, because by August 1920, and this is well documented in Professor Plochy's book, Poland signs an armistice with Soviet Russia, and now Petlura's war against Bolshevik Russia is now fought on his own, and then he will eventually go into exile, and that's a whole other story. So I'm going to stop there and just basically conclude with the statement that Pilsudski's, again, his vision was ahead of his times, where he was the only European statesman making the claim that without an independent Ukraine, Europe will never be secure. All right, thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much for that presentation.
Sure.
I'm sure there are lots of questions, so I will go ahead and open up the floor right away. And
sure,
you need a pen?
And I got my pen. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Yes, Sahi, please.
Thank you very much for coming. Thank you for this. For this presentation,
sure.
And congratulations on the publication of your book.
Oh,
we're sitting to reviews.
Oh, thank you.
One thing that came to mind is that it looks like that Zbigniew Brzezinski's formula that without Ukraine, Russia stops being empire, and with Ukraine continues to be empire, is maybe somehow was influenced by also by Pilsudski's formula about without Ukraine, there would be much more difficult to maintain independent Poland. The question that I have is with regard to the attitude toward the peace of Warsaw in Poland and among political elite. We know that it was controversial in Ukraine for obvious reasons of Galicia, but I wonder whether the tensions between what later became known as Pilsudski and Dabrowski's, you were already there as well, or when it comes to the Warsaw Treaty, there was agreement. And maybe related to that question is in right bank Ukraine in particular, the territory that was taken over by Pilsudski and Petlura armies, there was significant Polish landhold. Mm-hmm. They were of course not socialists, they were belonged to the more traditional and conservative groups. And it was a short period that the Polish army was there. But again, if we have any evidence whatsoever how they treated Pilsudski's troops, how they treated the Warsaw the Treaty of Warsaw.
Can you repeat that last part? The last part of your question.
Yeah, the last part of the question is my knowledge about that comes from a dissertation by my former student Marcel Garbusz, who wrote a special article on the Polish landholding groups.
Yes.
in around Kyiv and in right bank Ukraine, and they had very interesting ideas about their relation to the Polish state, where the Polish state should be, and so on and so forth. So if there is anything that you came across in your research related mm-hmm. to the Poles in Ukraine and how they treated the advance of the Pilsudski army, if you could comment on that.
So first of all, I'll start with the last question, which is I did not actually come across that. That would have been very interesting to me. But I tried to go through the various biographies of Pilsudski, which go back to the year 1915 and to the present day. But in the main scholarly ones, I did not come across that. That would be a very interesting, and in that dissertation, if that is discuss that I'd like to, I want to get that reference from you.
Sure, absolutely. And it seems to me there is also an article that waits to be published. So I'm sure Marcel will be happy to share that.
No, wonderful. And then your first question was about opposition. And I did want to say that there was actually some very strong opposition to Pilsudski's Kyiv campaign within the opposition party. So for example, I mentioned the speech he gave standing next to Petlura on May 17th, 1920, in Vinnytsia, and the next day he returns to Warsaw. He's hailed for the most part as a kind of heroic figure because it seems like he's going to be successful. But I didn't get to this part of the discussion, which is that the National Democratic Party chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, Stanisław Grabski, rose up and stated to Pilsudski that he said this was reckless overreach. He said that to have Kyiv in permanent possession, it would be necessary to go far beyond the Dnieper, and such a march would threaten Poland with a defeat like Napoleon in 1812. So he believed that this was kind of an unrealistic, but he also was really in a way anti-Ukrainian because he said we shouldn't be actually concerned with Ukraine. What we should be concerned with is kind of carving a border between the Soviets and Poland. So he begins by saying, why are you actually championing the independence of Ukraine? It's putting kind of like Poland at risk. And so I think that was shared by the opposition for sure.
Yes. I'm Michelle Visa. I'm at Ukrainian Research Institute.
So. Oh,
I wondered about Pilsudski's use of Napoleon. So I love the fact that you mentioned this,
And then he's come up again just in this last answer. Of course, Napoleon gets read very, very differently in not just in this part of the world, but in Spain. It's like the conqueror, it's very easy for some people to see an army of liberation, but people who have to suffer it just see the army. Yes. And so what I wondered is, it seems to be, just from the few words that you've spoken here, and I wonder if I'm hearing too much in it, that he was using this so much, the model of Napoleon, but not perhaps being blind to how it could be a negative image for the people in the way they perceive him. The people he had to have mobilized on his side, buying into his vision.
Yeah. So first of all, thank you for that question. It's one that I address in detail in the book because what I discovered in researching Pilsudski's childhood is that we know that at age 12, he and his older brother started a kind of clandestine journal, and he, and it's been confirmed, it's in Pilsudski's hand, he was writing quotations from Napoleon's letters. And I'm thinking, how did he... So where did he come up with, where did he get those? And then I discovered the source, which is that there's a in around that time, which was like around 1870. So it would be anticipating Pilsudski's age 12. There was a Polish translation of a biography of Napoleon, and that became very well read. And by the way, it's this Polish translation has his own history, which is that it was reprinted in the interwar period. And then in 2012, it got reprinted. And the back, the first thing it says is, this was Marshal Pilsudski's favorite book. That's actually the first sentence.
That's the blurb you want.
What was that?
That's the blurb you want.
Right. That's right. So this is the famous book. So I would say in Polish national psychology, Napoleon enters as a messianic figure. Because in the Grand Armée of approximately 600,000 that invaded Russia, 90,000 of them were Poles, and there were other ethnic groups. But even in Polish literature, the bards like Adam Mickiewicz in Pan Tadeusz, published in 1832, the setting are these lands in which they're anticipating the arrival of Napoleon's army and, of course, General Dabrowski's unit within that too, and as a liberating force. And of course, because under Napoleon, after the conquest of Prussia, that he allowed the creation of the Duchy of Warsaw in 1807, a kind of sovereign Polish entity, he is just kind of overwhelmingly seen in a positive light in Poland as a kind of champion of liberty. So that's why I felt that the way that, you know, when Pilsudski made his statement, which is something to the effect of, he said that the mission of Poland in Eastern Europe corresponds to France's mission in the West, that he, in a way, saw himself as a modern Napoleonic figure. But you're absolutely right that there are many who saw him as a conqueror, especially Lithuanians and Ukrainians, because he took Vilnius in April 1919, and then he took Lviv before that and all of East Galicia. So from their point of view, you're right, there's a complete contradiction between his view of himself as a liberator and the view of subject peoples who see him as a conqueror. But I think that was what he believed was Poland's mission, which is essentially that the territory of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth at its greatest extent, he believed that that was the eastern frontier of Western kind of civilization. And he was very unsettled by the idea that any of those lands would be under Russian rule.
And that would be the conception, the understanding that that's what the gentry would have embraced. Even with Mickiewicz, it's the gentry who are awaiting Napoleon, correct? And I guess I'm asking also the class side is where, so a lot of people just didn't care. It's as long as they got left alone.
Uh-huh.
I wonder like how much of a blind spot that was for Pilsudski, even about Poles.
You know that I'm not sure if I can really answer that. Maybe someone
Patrice or something about that class of issue, but certainly Pilsudski is raised in a household of conspiracy, because the shades are brought down, and in hushed voices, his mother on a nightly basis would pull the so-called secret books out of cabinets with lock and key and read to them the verses of Adam Mickiewicz, Zygmunt Krasinski, and Juliusz Słowacki, who were extolling the virtues of the nation and kind of aspiring towards kind of like regeneration of Poland.
Yes, please.
Question on the kind of contemporary context, if you don't mind.
On the what, sorry?
The contemporary context.
Yes.
Poland and kind of the growing authoritarian tendencies. I'm wondering how his legacy impacts the self-governance and authoritarianism in modern day Poland.
Uh-huh. So this is often discussed, and the way it kind of the interpretation I have is that the current populist government of Poland embraces embraces Pilsudski as the founding father of Poland, as the man who carved out modern Poland's frontiers, but it completely ignores his pluralistic views and ideas of tolerance against minorities, and also freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and on the other hand, we can say that the left in Poland, I believe, they embrace that part of Pilsudski: tolerance, freedom, and equal rights for all. But they downplay the turn to authoritarianism. I think, but that's where, because it's interesting that the populist government will celebrate Pilsudski, but not that aspect of his past.
Mm-hmm.
No, please.
So thanks, Josh.
Yeah,
it's a great and some good questions. But just to pick up on this, so would you like to say then that today, past 10 years of, or the past 8 years of the peace government, Pilsudski has become this consensual historical figure that 80 or 90% of Poles can basically rally around and agree upon in this strange way? And then how do you explain that this, of all the different historical events in Poland, this is the one thing that perhaps unites Poles?
Yeah.
Well, this obviously, and you know, becomes part of a new canon, he becomes reformulated. Is this what you're thinking?
Yeah. He has this mantle of being the founding father of modern Poland. And since the fall of communism, right, he's emerged as this great, as this, venerated and celebrated figure. What's interesting is that during the Cold War, what we had was on the one hand, a demonization of Pilsudski behind the Iron Curtain, but it wasn't only behind the Iron Curtain, actually, because the followers of Roman Dmowski in the West also put out books that referred to him as, and I'm thinking a particular figure in London in the 1970s, put out a biography of Pilsudski that called him an enemy of Poland, who was neither a Pole nor a Catholic. And really came down hard on Pilsudski's legacy. But in general, he was demonized in communist Poland, right, as a foe of progress, an enemy of liberty, as an anti-communist, and then he was called a fascist. So it seems like the gamut was so wide. But then, of course, after the fall of communism, I think you're right, he's a unifying figure, even if there still are some critics, right, of Pilsudski. But it seems that the growing consensus is a very kind of positive view, but it involves the act of forgetting.
As history does in general.
Yeah, no, exactly. No, it's
the ABC of our profession.
Yeah, no, it's one of those famous 19th century essays that the construction of nationhood involves the act of forgetting those shameful parts of one's past. So the turn to authoritarianism in 1926, but then we have this, we have this troubling issue of 1930, 1931, when he orders the arrest of members of parliament for an alleged conspiracy to overthrow the government. It's called the Brzeszcz affair, because there was like a kind of internment place for these political prisoners. And I'm not completely aware of how that is viewed, And then in 1934, there is a kind of a camp for radicals, right? For but this relates to the subject of Ukraine, because this camp that's opened in Bereza Kartuska in 1934, it's for both far right extremists, but then also communists and some Ukrainians, right? Ukrainian nationalists from the East Galicia part. And so I have to say, I don't know how those are addressed today in Poland, those aspects of the biography. I think that they're downplayed.
Any other questions here? I'm looking to see if there's something online here, but the ones have been answered. Okay. Well, let me just ask you a question.
Yeah,
you are the expert on Pilsudski now.
Yeah.
There's no denying that with this big book. How singular a voice really was he in all of this? I mean, are there any echoes of other people besides this one folder that you quoted, who seems to be very much in the enthrall of Pilsudski?
Yes, yeah.
With the historical references and everything.
Yep.
I mean, who else is behind him, or are people behind him, and are they behind him for the same reasons that you highlighted today, the Ukrainian cause?
Oh, I see. Well, I think that he represents a current in Polish thought, which does see Poland as having a mission of kind of, you know, pushing Russia back to its ethnic frontiers and allowing for a national existence and freedom of choice in those areas. So in terms of, he had many followers. And so I for some reason, I can't think of a specific name of a particular follower of his right now. But he clearly had, clearly was venerated, especially by, because remember, he was a leader of the Polish Socialist Party until 1916, when he decided that to become a national leader, he had to be kind of like nonpartisan. But if I could say, let's say one other thing, going back to the Jewish support, I want to just mention that if anyone here is familiar with the works of Arthur Schick, the Polish artist from the 1920s, 1930s. And so he dedicated to Pilsudski, and I have this on the PowerPoint, a book called The Statute of Kalisz that came out actually in 1928 in Paris, based on an exhibition of 44 paintings. And it basically traces that history of Jews settling Polish lands. And it takes, interestingly, all the way up to the Polish legions. And there are images of Jews in the Polish Legion. So it's one of, let's say, the distinctive features of his brigade, the first brigade of the Polish Legions, that we believe that in Galicia, about 10% were Jewish. And so it showed that somehow his vision attracted minorities. And I think that this is one of his distinctive features, I would say. But could I ask, since we have Ukrainian specialists, when I made the statement that he was the only European leader after World War I to champion the independence of Ukraine, are there other statesmen after World War I? Because I couldn't find one, but I just wanted to throw that out and see. And I want to make sure that you would regard that as an accurate statement.
I think it is an accurate statement. I would add that Pilsudski is someone who continued tradition that started really in late 18th century about thinking about importance of a Ukrainian state, and that at that point the thoughts were about the Cossack state, which would be in the Dnieper area, and that would serve to a degree as a buffer state between Russia and Poland. So in that sense, again, we can trace back that sort of ideas to the late 18th century.
Mm-hmm.
And he is, my understanding is certainly the champion of the federalist solution of the minorities, question of minorities in the bigger Poland that he wanted to restore,
right?
The pre-partition one. And I don't know about federalism again, whether he had any forerunners in that sense. So it's basically, federalism is also something that socialists in general at that time are very much interested in and discuss and debate. So I'm not sure, but I would say that the idea of the federalist organization of the future Polish state, mm-hmm. he is there probably not just the most prominent figure, but maybe one of the first people who started thinking about it. Not the first, absolutely, but one of the first.
And then I don't know if there's more time, but if there's more
I believe there still is time. Yes.
Okay.
If you've got questions that you would like to pose.
No, only to mention that when I say the only European statesman after World War I, of course, my first thought of that is before World War I, and that is the famous Treaty of Brest-Litovsk of February 1918, in which it's a subject of continuing fascination for me, in which Ukrainian National Republic signs an agreement with the Central Powers, Bulgaria and Turkey, which formally recognizes Ukrainian independence. And then it's followed 1 month later with the Bolshevik treaty with the Central Powers. And I went into that treaty, and what I find so interesting is that it forced the actual leaders of Bolshevik Russia to recognize the independence of Ukraine, but it also has a clause in there that says that they agree to stop incitement against Ukraine. So I found that very interesting. And of course, it's one of those what ifs of history about, you know, if the Central Powers had actually been victorious, there would have been likely right after the conclusion of war and some kind of independent Ukraine. What we don't know is in what form. But we do have a map that was produced in the course of that treaty, which shows that, of course, it does not include any Austrian lands. So they were not willing to give up East Galicia. But nonetheless, it's an important moment, would you agree, in the history of the Ukrainian national movement, that they actually did get two great powers at one point to back them. But of course, this treaty is annulled, null and void after World War I, and no similar backing comes from the Western, the great powers of the West. So I think that's important.
Any further questions?
If that's all that we have, please join me in thanking both our speaker and our moderator, Joshua and Patrice.
We're very much appreciated.
Thank you for that. And to all of you, please join us same place, same time next week. We will have a lecture by Yana Primachenko, Historical Fakes in Russian Media During the First Phase of the Russian Aggression Against Ukraine, 2014 through 2016. So please join us next week.
Very interesting.
Wonderful image. Yes. Thank you. Oh, no. My in-laws. That's great.